Good morning, SML. Happy Friday. We're back after a short hiatus. Eminem in the Morning is back. Yes, we were off 2 weeks because I was in Chicago and Matt got gonorrhea or something. I don't know. What's going on, Matt?
Hey, man. Good to be here. Don't forget, I was also at Lambeau Field watching the speaking of gonorrhea, I was watching the Seahawks. They didn't score a point. Then I caught the plague, but I'm back and I'm ready for some playoffs.
Let's go, yeah. So when this episode comes out, it's going to be week 18 as of last night, or maybe this morning if Prime waits to advance. I don't know if he's going to wake up or not. But as of KJ o'clock, we are officially in week 18. So we're just going to – it might be a little bit of a shorter episode, but we're going to give you a week 18 preview today. Let's kick it off right now. Matt, I want you to pick one matchup, and we'll talk about that first.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a glaring one that just stands out when I look at Week 18, and that's going to be the Chargers and the Cardinals for a couple of reasons. One, on dump side, he's fighting for the one seed. He can technically get it if he wins and QP loses, which is possible. He plays Green Bay, which is right now a playoff team. But beyond that, it's a little personal. Dan did make a mention that he respects everybody in the league but one person. He didn't name any names, but you could figure it out. So I'm excited for that one.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because we had that whole controversy where Dan lost three games in a row, but he did win in week 17, and now he's headed in at 12-4. He still has a shot to win the division, I believe, because I believe he at least split with Prime. I'd have to go back and check, but he at least split with Prime this season. And yeah, he beat Fig 24-14. Man, I don't know. I don't know. I want to pick the Chargers just because I think Dan's a better player, right? But right now he's not.
Yeah,
it's weird. I'm gonna have to take dump in this game.
Yeah, Dan's not playing well. I watched most of that Niners game and he was down 14-0. He threw a pick six with the rookie, and then the rookie fumbled and that was returned for a touchdown. Then he put Goff in and he ended up winning. If Fig never scored on offense, and he won like 24-14, but he's not playing well. He didn't play well against Colt. He's just not. I didn't see his game against you, but you're a solid opponent. There's nothing wrong with that, but he shouldn't lose to someone like Colt. No offense. Dan should win those games, especially going into the playoffs. He did sweep Prime, and I'm sure Dan would like us to make sure that that is noted. So he technically could win the division if he beats Dump and Prime loses to Null. But yeah, Dump's playing better. Dump has the better team. Give me the Cardinals in this one.
All right, let's hop over to that Chiefs-Seahawks game because that's another big one. 13-3 Chiefs, 12-4 Seahawks going at it. Seahawks, I guess Dump would have the tiebreaker in that division. He does. So, I mean, Seahawks are playing for the division. So are the Chiefs, because if the Chiefs lose and the Chargers win, Chargers are going to win the division. And same on the Seahawks side. If the Seahawks win, Cardinals lose, Seahawks win the division. So, two really big games right there. I got to be consistent and just take my boy Prime, because I don't know. I've been against Noel all season. He beat me earlier in the year, so just out of spite, I'm going to take Prime.
Yeah, you know, it's going to be interesting, because I thought I saw something in chat that, I think it was in Prime's game recap on his win over Field, that he was going to bench players except for Whitfield going for Rookie of the Year. That's an interesting move, because we just talked about how he's not clinched the division, and if he loses to Noel, who is a definitely some competition, he would lose that division and he'd be in the wild card. But again, that would make him the fifth seed, which nobody respects the AFC South, so maybe he just looks at it as I'm the two or the five, and the five's fine with me. But Noel gets Chris Carson back, 6.1 yards per carry. I mean, in not top of the league, but 91 broken tackles, that leads the league. That's 8 more than Chubb and 7 more than Aaron Jones. Chris Carson is a beast. Whoever plays Noel, whether it's, you know, obviously week 18 or in the playoffs, they have their hands full. So I'm actually going to take Noel in this one if Prime benches his starters. If he doesn't, give me Prime.
There's no chance that Prime will bench his players. I know he says he's going to, but after all the crap that he gives me over benching players in that one time that I didn't have something locked up that I thought was locked up, there's no way he's going to do that, because unless he goes big brain and tries to out-tank Dan for the 5 seed, in which case, bravo, I give it a hats off to you. But no, there's no way that the Chiefs are going to bench players unless they're up, you know, 3 scores in the third quarter. They're going to play at least the whole first half.
It would be the smart thing to do. Maybe he thinks Dan can't beat Dump or won't beat Dump, but I know we both just picked Dump, but that could still go either way. I wouldn't be so sure about Dan losing ever. So it'll be interesting to see what Prime does.
No, and back to that Chargers-Cardinals game, it's like, I right before I took the Dump, I was going to take the Chargers. And because I think Dan is a better player, I think he was a better player the first 10 games of the season. But right now, just Dump is playing better. He's playing like head and shoulders better than Dan is right now. So it really could go either way. But, you know, we both took the Cardinals for a reason. So let's hop over now to on what paper should be a big game. The New Orleans Saints versus the not tanking Buccaneers. I'm going to take the Buccaneers. I know it's going to surprise some people, but I'm taking the Bucs.
Yeah, and I'm going to avoid the obvious trap part of this question. I think Pauly's going to come out slinging, and I think he's really, really going to try to win this game. Klink is on the verge of something special. I've watched his games. He is, and this is me talking to him because we're the same. He's offensively challenged, but his quarterback is a problem, and I don't know what he's going to do this offseason, but his quarterback's going to prevent him from doing anything in the playoffs if he makes it. But he plays stellar defense. He can run the ball. I'm going to take Klink. I think Klink is a better player than Pauly this version. I think he beats him even if Pauly's trying. So I'm going to take Klink in that one, and I think he gets in the playoffs, and I don't think he does much, but he's going to win that game.
Here's the deal. Pauly says he's not tanking, so he's going to play Tom Brady in this game. Tom Brady, yes, I know he's like 80 years old, but listen, Kyle Trask is not the answer. Tom Brady, through the course of this season, has averaged 5 yards per attempt more than Kyle Trask has. That's ridiculous. Tom Brady's over 13 yards per attempt. Kyle Trask is in the 8 range. That's ridiculous. That's a huge number. That's like leading the league versus near bottom of the league difference right there. And that's same guy throwing the ball. Tom Brady's going to come out, and you know, the Bucs, they say they're not tanking. They're going to come out with a fire to prove they're not tanking, to pick up their 4th win of the season, and they're going to beat the Saints. That's my prediction.
Yeah, and Brady might be a million years old, but man, I'm looking at his attributes, and whew, his passing attributes are still stellar. I mean, he's a beast.
Yeah, I mean, listen, he's 45 years old, but, you know, he's still in the 90s. He's an X factor. He's Tom Brady. Like, you know, he's probably, if he doesn't retire, he's a usable quarterback for at least the next season, maybe 2 or more seasons. And I think last Madden, he didn't end up retiring, like, at all. Like, he was, like, 52 and, like, a 57 overall, but he was still in the league.
Yeah, I'm a full believer that EA has coded some logic to make Tom Brady never retire. I mean, who knows? He may never retire in real life. The guy keeps saying he could play forever, so I don't think he's going to retire either. He's definitely going to be usable next season. He will definitely be on a team. That free agency bidding will be wild. I don't know. I'm assuming Paulie's going to give up on him, but he's a beast, and I think he should start him. He should try and win that game, because I think he can knock Klink out of the playoffs potentially, or at least maybe knock him down a peg. So it'll be interesting.
Yeah, side tangent here. I think that Tom Brady thing last cycle was a glitch, because 2 Maddens ago, it used to be like, okay, anybody over 35, they're going to retire immediately, like after the first season. And then they came out and said, well, Tom Brady hasn't retired. And Madden has said he's retired every year for the last 10 years. So we're going to code it so that older players are more unpredictable when they retire, especially Tom Brady. Tom Brady will not retire after the first season, and it'll be like random when he does retire. I think they glitched it and just programmed it accidentally that he would just never retire.
Yeah, you're probably right. That sounds
it's
like EA.
I know that.
Yeah.
That's pure speculation on my part, but they did say that first part. So anyways, a play-in game here for one team. We got the 4-12 49ers. Not a play-in game for them. The 10-6 Raiders, week 18, 49ers Raiders, battle of the Bay Area. Hey, Jace Move looks good. He's in that driver's seat for the 7th seed in the AFC. And I believe he could potentially get a 6th seed even, depending on what happens in the Ravens game we'll talk about later. But what do you think happening in this game? I don't think there's really much of a discussion to be had here.
Yeah, if he loses to Fig, it's the ultimate choke job. And I just don't see it happening. He's a good player. He's got Aaron Rodgers, who's just a remarkable quarterback. On the flip side, though, Fig is hot and cold. He's more cold than hot, but I mean, he can compete. He had Dan a little bit on the ropes early, first half of that game. And he's not playing. I mean, he has no reason to lose the game. I believe you have his first round pick, so it's not like he's like, I don't really want to win because if I don't win, at least I have a good pick. Doesn't have that attitude, so he's probably going to go in and knowing that he can maybe knock the Raiders out of the playoffs. Shoot, you have nothing to lose. Go in there and give it everything you've got. But I've still got Dunkface or Jay Spoof pulling that one out, and probably by multiple scores.
Figs has had a really tough second half of the schedule, but his four wins are over the 1-15 Broncos, the 3-13 Falcons, the 5-11 Eagles, and most recently in week 11, he beat the 9-7 Vikings. So, you know, that's a quality win. I'll give you that one. In reality, though, I mean, he has not won any games that he maybe should have been favored in. I don't really think it'll be much of a competition. He has not really been playing it close. He did play it close against Dan, but Dan's got his own issues. Lost by over 20 points to the Cardinals, lost by over 30 points to the Rams, two scores to the Saints, two scores to the Chiefs, and week 12 was his last one score loss, which was 28-21 over the currently 6-10 Jets. So Fig, he's going up against a hot Raiders team. I just can't go against Smooth and the Raiders, so I'm taking the Raiders.
Yeah, I think everybody's probably, and I think anybody would pick the Raiders here, but give him hell, Fig. See what you can do.
I'm here for it. Anyways, flipping over to the other side of that play-in game, the guy most looking to benefit from a 49ers win, we've got the 9-7 Dolphins versus the 6-10 Bears. That would be me as Miami. I would like to win, and Fig, I'm rooting for you here, buddy, but I don't think it's happening. So in reality, this Bears-Dolphins game only matters if the 49ers wins. Otherwise, it's who wants to worsen their draft spot? And I would like to worsen my draft spot, so I'm going to take myself.
Yeah, you know, you can't sleep on future. He might be 6-10, but he was a playoff team last year. He's played a lot of close games. He lost to QP by 5. He lost to Faz by 3. You know, he's hung around. He's a good player. It's a good team. It's a good Madden team. Watch out for Khalil Mack. But yeah, I think you're going to win this game. And maybe if it ends up being meaningless, regardless. But I think you're the better player. You're playing better this season. You got this one.
Now, let's not forget the future is historically one of the better players in the SML. We're not too far removed, less than maybe just over two calendar years removed from future being a top three regular season guy at least. And he has not been that of late, but he is still capable of pulling out big wins in big situations. Correct me if I'm wrong, he did make the playoffs last season, right?
He did.
He did. Yep. Okay. So I'm right about that. I recalled that correctly. Good job for me. All right, moving on. We got a game I think many people would have expected to have higher ramifications this late in the season. It's week 18. Get the 13-3 Bills versus, and get ready for this gory ass record, 6-8-2 Patriots. I hate that with a passion. I love ties, and I hate that record so much. 6-8-2. It's like, okay, one tie, you get back to 500. Two ties, now we're back on that weird, like, now you've only got 15 games that count. Like, that's ugly. Anyways, Bills are going to win unless they rest their starters, which they shouldn't because they're still playing for the 2 seed. I don't know. It doesn't matter. I guess 2 and 3 doesn't really matter. So it's just who would you like to play? If Faz wants to play the 7 seed, which will likely be the Raiders, or if he wants to play the Ravens, who probably not a good matchup, or at least more likely to give him issues. So I don't expect him to take this game lightly. I think he'll come out and win. He'll probably bench his starters in the second half, though.
Yeah, I can't figure out Duck Boy. He's a good player. I think he is a good player. I don't know, he's inconsistent. And when he played Faz the first time, Faz didn't have to do anything. Josh Allen threw 11 passes. He completed 9 of them, 249 yards, 3 touchdowns. But you know why he didn't have to do anything? Matthew Stafford threw 6 interceptions. Matthew Stafford did throw for almost 400 yards, 399 on 16 completions. 7 of those to Deontay Johnson for 267 yards. So he definitely favors that receiver. But yeah, I don't know. I think Faz wants to win as many AFC East games as he can, even though this game might not mean anything. He's gonna come out. He's gonna win this game, and I think he probably wins it handily. They won't tie. I'll say that. They will not tie.
Well, I'm not so sure about that. But the Patriots, yeah, you're right. I just can't figure them out. They came out and they started the season really hot. They started 2-0, then they tied with the Packers. Then after that tie with the Packers, I don't know. I think something about that tie, that one in the tie column, just completely broke the Patriots here, and broke Bean Boy, and he just collapsed. He won week 2. Okay, he beat ZZ, who's about to maybe win that division, by the way. He beat ZZ 48-13 in week 2. That was his last win until week 13. He went on a massive slide. That's, if I can do my math properly, which don't get your hopes up, he lost like 6 games in a row. Maybe 7. No, there's a tie in there as well. So, I don't know. He didn't win a game until week 13 after winning in week 2. And then since then, has played pretty decently. He beat the Lions. He beat the Rams, who are borderline playoff team this year. He beat the Broncos, which, you know, I think if he had lost to the Broncos, that might have gotten thrown into the conspiracies, are you tanking video. So, got his ass handed to him by Faz the first time. Not going to compete, my opinion, of the second time. But he's a really interesting team, and I have no idea what to expect from him next season.
He's one of the better runners in the league. I think I actually put him as my number one. He's got Damian Harris third in the league in rushing yards, 7.3 yards a carry, 24 touchdowns. And Damian Harris is nothing special. Everybody around him, Najee Harris isn't anything special, but he has 72 more carries. But everybody else around him that's in reasonable range of attempts, they're all super fast and or have overpowered abilities, and Damian Harris doesn't have any of those. He's 90 speed and he has balance beam. So Duck Boy's got the foundation of running down. He needs to cut back on the turnovers, and I don't know if that's Stafford or him or a combination of both, figure it out, and then just play some solid defense if he can. That's, you know, he's got Stephon Gilmore, who's aging. He lost JC Jackson with the trade I made with Sherm. But he's got a chance here in this offseason, I think, to retool. Damian Harris isn't going anywhere. He's a young back. He's got a young core. I have faith in Duck Boy. I can't figure him out, but for some reason I've got faith in him. He's got talent.
I want to immediately contradict what you said about Damian Harris being nothing special. He fits the mold for a great running back this Madden. Any other year, I'd have agreed with you. But 90 speed, 93 acceleration, 92 carrying. And then you'd stack that on top of 86 juke move for a guy that is... Oh, he's not as big as I thought he was. He's only 5'10", 213. But he plays like a big running back. 87 change of direction, 88 agility. That's like perfect. I mean, speed's nice. But 90 speed, that is like your base running back speed. I mean, Clyde Edwards-Helaire is out here with 86 speed, and he's still like a solid Madden running back this year, as I know from another league, not based on what Prime has done with him. But yeah, Damian Harris is good. Patriots, not so much. If you could just, man, this offense is electric. If you just don't throw interceptions, you probably win 12, 13 games. Because Damian Harris has 1,800 rushing yards. You would think that means the passing game isn't that good, because 250 carries to the running back, that's going to take away from your passing numbers, right? No, it hasn't. 4,200 passing yards on top of that. That is a borderline top five number in the league. 30 touchdowns, that is solid. That's like not top five, probably not top 10, but you know, that's a good number for passing touchdowns. 34 interceptions though, you got to cut those out, and that's what really has killed him this year.
Yeah, and I think he needs to get a wide receiver. He's got Deontay Johnson, who's honestly more of a slot guy. He's got I think Malik Craig is a rookie, but he's normal dev. So he needs to retool wide receiver, whether that's free agency, the draft, or a combination of both. You know, have guys that can get open more. But I believe in Duckboy. I mean, he's obviously not going to win this division with Faz in it. He's probably, you know, and you're probably going to beat down on him too, at least split if you don't sweep him. But I could see this. I could see him squeezing in the six or seven seed. I think he's got potential. I played him this season. I did beat him, but it was a very close game. It could have gone either way. So I have faith in you, Duck Boy.
Got some non-related SML news, or non-related to the SML news. Just some breaking news here on the podcast. The Memphis Grizzlies have defeated the Oklahoma City Thunder 152-79. So, oof. That's the largest margin of victory in NBA history. Not that it matters for this podcast, but I just got a notification on my phone, wanted to throw it in there, because that's an ass beating. All right, that's probably worse than what Faz is going to do to Bean Boy. All right, I tied it in. See, full circle. All right, let's hop now to a game that won't be that good. Or, you know, it might be a good game, but really does not impact a whole lot. 1-15 Broncos, 6-10 Titans. Now, let's not forget that Titans team, they are playing for a playoff spot. They tied for the division lead last season, and they missed out on the tiebreakers. They, I do not believe, are leading in tiebreakers right now. That would be ZZ, also at that 6-10 mark.
Can I interrupt you for a second?
Yeah, go ahead.
Did you just say the 6-10 Titans? The 6-10 Titans are playing for a playoff spot? Playoffs?
Oh, yeah. I mean, they need some help.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. That AFC South, I tell you what.
I love it. I love chaos. I love it. I was rambling on because in my head I couldn't find the division standings button. Okay, so... The Jaguars have recently taken the league. The Jaguars are 7-9 in that division. So Jaguars are winning in, but the Texans and Titans are both right there at 6-10. Fields going to need some help, and let me double check here the head-to-head with the Jaguars. Nope, Field is done. All right. Well, never mind about that.
Field... Well, if it's a three-way tie, though, I don't think head-to-head counts. So head-to-head's only the... tiebreaker in a two tie situation.
I don't know how it applies to, well, it would come down to division record then, I believe,
which I think they would all have the same. So I don't want to go down that rabbit hole, because I don't know, because if the Jags lose, they'd lose to the Colts, which would make them 3-3 in the division, just like the Texans and just like the Titans.
I take it back. I hate this.
That's a whole show in and of itself that we could probably break down the tiebreakers in the AFC South. But anyways, Titans Broncos, a thriller.
Yeah. Anyways, we'll get back to that when we talk more about the Jaguars game. But yeah, you could flip a coin for it. I don't think anyone would call it tanking, but I don't think that Fins is gonna necessarily want to win this game, and Field does want to win this game. So and for that reason, I'm gonna take the Titans.
Well, I don't care if Fins wants to win the game anyway. Field's an excellent offensive player. And maybe excellent is a strong word, but he's a good offensive player. Derrick Henry, I mean, just hold up. And then he has a good passing game. He torched me more than anyone else has. Faz, anybody, he torched me. He always found the open guy. He's got good receivers in Julio and AJ Brown. Fins can't get out of his own way. He's in his head. I think he just needs an offseason to regroup. Cut down on the turnovers, Fins. You're in a lot of games. You're in a lot more than you think you are. The final scores of his games are not always indicative of how it went. He makes some really bad decisions throwing the ball. If he cuts that down and shortens the game, doesn't give the ball away, I'm not going to say he's going to go 10-7 all of a sudden, but he won't be 1-16 all the time. So, Titans are winning this game. By at least two scores.
Yeah, like you said, Titans have a good passing offense. Turnovers, again, too high, but, you know, I can accept it. When your interceptions are less than your touchdowns, that's really all I care about. Yeah, I mean, you've probably lost some games because you've thrown those interceptions, but you've thrown 27 touchdowns, too. And that's just with Ryan Tannehill. Let's not forget that Ryan Tannehill has had a very tumultuous season, and Cam Newton was the starter here for, you know, I think probably two games. And even with Cam Newton, 7 touchdowns, 6 interceptions. So not terrible. I mean, not as good as Tannehill, but not terrible. And on top of that, let's not forget that as the full-time starter for the Titans last season, Ryan Tannehill was top 5 in passing yardage. So, hey, it's an explosive offense. The Broncos have the talent, I think, defensively to keep up, but just you're not gonna stop everybody. And Field doesn't make as many mistakes as some other people in the league. So Titans are gonna win the game.
Yeah, I think Fields, just if he just figures out how to play defense. I mean, he doesn't have to play good defense, just better than what he's doing now. He's pretty much dead last in almost all the defensive categories. If he just increased that to like low 20s, he'd probably run away with this division with the way he plays offense. And 6-10 Titans, that's about all I can say about them. They're 6-10.
Speaking of dumpster fire, let's talk about the Jaguars and Colts. Jaguars and Colts met once earlier in the season. Colts dominated 31-7 in week 7. That brought the Colts record to 4-2. Matt, if you realize anything about the number 4, please point it out. No, you don't? Okay, I'll help you out. 4 is still the number of wins that the Colts have.
Oh, jeez.
4th win of the season came in week 7, and we are now in week 18. The Colts have lost 10 straight games, and now they went from, hey, look, the Colts might have a winning record. We might get a winning record out of the AFC East, or South, or whatever division that is. It's the South. And now the Colts are going to get a top 5 draft pick, probably. So, the wheels fell off in a hurry. Mike, I sympathize with you. You had a tough schedule, okay? You had to play ZZ and the Texans. You had to play Field and the Titans. And you had to play DW and the Jets and ZZ again. Those are all not bad teams.
Yeah. I don't really know what to say about the Colts. I played him and he couldn't stop me. He couldn't stop Dwayne Haskins.
I didn't even throw you in there because you have a winning record. So.
Yeah, I mean, I I saw him play against ZZ. I honestly think that was the game I watched. I think he got absolutely torched. And then ZZ goes out and loses by 50 to NYT. And NYT is good, but you shouldn't lose by 50 to anybody. So, yeah, Mike's season really fell apart. He's the first to admit it. He's not making excuses. But I do think, and we'll probably get some clarification after this releases and people listen to it, I think this is a CPU game. I do think that Coop was out of town when he lost 31-7. Based on the stats, it just doesn't look like a user game. So based on what I just said, and the fact that we don't edit on this show, I really hope that it was a CPU game, because that's awfully offensive to Coop if I just said that and he did play this game. But I think Coop's going to win this game. Mike can't stop a thing in the air, and I think Coop's going to do enough to win this game. The Jaguars are a much better team, much, much better team. ETN is a stud. Lawrence, obviously, great Madden quarterback. He's got speed at wide receiver, good little defense. He's going to win this game. He's going to get in the playoffs, and he's going to destroy all hope of chaos with the three-way tie in the AFC South.
You know, we could edit on the show. I thought about getting a button that would just bleep out whatever I say, just so I can say whatever I want. Just pull a full DW and just go at it. But, yeah, so if that was a CPU game, that means that Mike has lost 11 straight user games, because prior to picking up that fourth win, he lost 48-27 to the Eagles, who, by the way, have 5 wins. But, I mean, hey, all those linebackers, I understand how tough that defense is. Listen, Jaguars are going to win the game. They're going to win the division.
Yeah, props to Mike, though. Week one, he only lost a 3 by Dan. Highlight of the season right there. I mean, when that happened, we were talking deep playoff run for Mike. He's back. He beats Fins. Oh my goodness. Well, he should, but he beats Fins. Wow. Then he beats Field. Oh my goodness. Beats KJ 4-0. And like you said, the wheels fell off. It's just,
well, 3-1 because he lost to Dan. But...
Oh yeah, lost to Dan. Excuse me. But morally, that's a win. Losing by only by 3
yeah,
to Dan.
No, of course.
Morally, it's a win. So morally, he's 4-1, or 4-0. But yeah, some of these games aren't even close. So you can't lose 38-7 to ZZ. I'm sorry, but yeah. Anyways, he could play spoiler to his good buddy Coop. He could play spoiler. He will try to play spoiler. Mike will never, ever not try to win a game. So I'm actually interested in that game, because Coop and Mike, you know, they're buddy-buddy. They're friends. They've known each other for a long time. I played in Madden Leagues with them forever. So they've got good sportsmanship. And I know Mike's going to want to create chaos and maybe knock Coop out. So I'm excited about that.
I am quickly looking up my sad music to play in the background while I go on a short little soapbox here. Let's see if we can get to... Oh, that's too loud. All right. Mike, listen, buddy. I don't know what went wrong for you, but it's really sad. You're a 500 guy in my eye. That should be good enough to make the playoffs in this division, in this conference that is ridiculous, and that 11-win teams are going to miss the playoffs in. But you're a good player, man. Don't let that 4-13 that's coming your way deter you from putting crappy players on the field at a time. You know, you take that Derek Carr and you throw for 5,000 yards with him. I believe in you. But you gotta do better than 4 wins, dude. You gotta give me like a 9-8 or an 8-9. We gotta get 500 Mike back. I miss 500 Mike. We need 500 Mike. The SML needs 500 Mike. And it's a sad day in the SML when we have to admit that you just might not be that player anymore. But that's okay, because the Colts will rise again. I think for the sake of your team, you should probably re-raise the Prime Era banners, because I think taking those down really affected your team. But once you raise those back up, the Colts will come back. Listen, the Colts are going to win a division at least once this season. And the Colts, listen, we predicted it last season. I know a couple of podcasts actually have predicted, hey, the last place team in the AFC South, they're going to turn around and they're going to win the division, because that division is so bad that the last place schedule just might flip it. And you know what? That's what's going to happen. The Colts are going to win the division in season 44. You heard it here first. And that's enough of the sad music. All right. What were we talking about?
Well, we were talking about the 4-12 Colts for a long time, and hopefully Mike accepts your challenge. But we were talking about the Jags beating the Colts and going to the playoffs.
Ah, yes, playoffs. That's what we were talking about. Okay, back to my Week 18 schedule. We just talked Colts, Jaguars. Let's move on. Well, you know what? Let's just finish the AFC South, so we don't have to talk about it anymore. We got the 6-10 Texans going up against the 5-10-1 Bengals. Listen, I don't know what to expect here because Spooky started out really badly and he's won a couple of games. He even tied a game. So that was against, I bet it was the Patriots. And it was. I don't know what to expect here. I thought ZZ was going to win this division, but I think right now Spooky's a better player. So I'm going to take the Bengals.
Yeah, Spooky's solid. I've said it numerous times that he's not that far away. He plays well. He's a good passer. He can't really run that well, at least in games versus me. But I think he just likes to pass. So I don't think he. I think he just runs to run like Baz. And he just recently beat me, 11-9 in a nice little baseball game there. Maybe a scoregami. I think he's gonna win this game too. I see flashes from ZZ where he looks really good. But then I need to realize he's playing, you know, AFC South. People when I think that, so and I know that Spooky's 5-10-1, but I think he's better than that, and he loves that rookie QB, and I think he comes out slinging. I think he wins that game.
I mean, hey, let's not forget the Texans could still win the division. Let me go back and make sure they didn't get swept. No, they did not. So listen, it comes down to it. Jaguars lose, Texans could win the division. You got a favorable matchup, ZZ. Listen, buddy, if you want to be taken seriously this cycle, you need to win this game, period. I'm going to take you. I'll make you a deal, ZZ. You win this game, I will take you seriously for the rest of the cycle. I mean it. I will not say a bad word about the Texans on a podcast, on anything. You are going to be my pick for the AFC South every season. That part's probably not true, but I will take you seriously, I promise. Just if you win the game. And Spooky, you know what you're playing for. You're playing for your pride, and I love you, so.
Yeah. Get it done, Spooky.
Eminem in the morning.
Rep the AFC North.
Spooky. All right, okay. Now, enough of the bad teams. Let's go back to two more bad teams. 5-11 Eagles versus 2-13 Giants. God, I don't know what to pick, but I'm going to pick the Eagles because they have the better record, and it's a rivalry game, and I think they married sisters or something, so I don't know, something about Tennessee.
Yeah, something Tennessee, something sisters. I'm gonna pick KJ just because I love KJ, and he beat him the first time. I hope he beats him again, but that'll probably be played at KJ o'clock, and I like the night games, but I'm not too sure. I might tune into that one, we'll see, but yeah, that's a pointless game, but it is a big rivalry game. I'm sure the entire Tiny and KJ households get together for that, throw a little party. But give me KJ.
Oh.
He's my boy.
We're getting a KJ pick. All right, listen. Hey, guys, you know what would be cool is if you guys went to each other's houses. I know you live close. And you just swap controllers. KJ plays as the Eagle. Tiny plays as the Giants. Just for Week 18. I think it'd be hilarious. As an admin, I have to discourage that. But as a podcast host, I love that idea. All right, moving on. Let's finally, two teams with winning records. The football team, 11-5 versus the 9-7 Vikings. This is a good game on paper. This is a good game in the what I expect to be the box score, and it's a good game on standings. The 11-5 football team. You don't even have a football name, and you've won 11 games. I'm impressed with how NYT has been playing this season. I am less impressed with how DMuse is playing, but he rebounded nicely after like a 2-2 or 0-3 start or something.
Yeah, I too. I didn't. NYT being 11-5 really surprised me. I honestly didn't even know he was 11-5 fluke until I got ready for the show. DMuz is playing for his playoff life. If he loses this game and he drops into a two-way tie with Colt, I haven't done any research, but if Woods beats Bomber, if he beats Bomber and DMuz loses to NYT, then Woods would take his spot. So I don't know. I know NYT's 11-5 fluke, but I'm taking the Vikings. DMuz, dominant player. I shouldn't say dominant, but last cycle he was kind of dominant. He's gonna focus up. He's gonna win this game.
Hey, just so we're clear here, the Vikings do have the tiebreaker over the Panthers. So as of right now, the Vikings are the 7th seed, and the Panthers are the first team out of the 8th seed. Yeah, I'm impressed with the Vikings, what they've done, what they've overcome. They started 1-3 after losing to 3 pretty mediocre teams in the Jets, the Eagles, and myself. And I feel like I can call myself mediocre because that was my first win of the season in week 4. So, but then he turned around. He beat the Lions in week 5 to pick up just his second win of the season. He's got wins over the Cowboys, the Panthers. That turned out to be a good win. Win over the Packers, who we'll talk about later, but they rebounded nicely. Win over the Colts, barely. Good job. And then he lost to the 49ers, and I don't understand that one at all. But he comes out, he drops 50 on the Patriots, drops one of the Packers. He rebounded nicely from that slow start. He's got a winning record. Gotta finish it off with this win here, because you need it to make the playoffs. We haven't talked Panthers yet, but let's just quickly, the Panthers play the Browns, so realistically you probably are in either way, but listen, you need the win, and I don't think you're confident in your team going in at 9-8 versus 10-7. So
yeah, and Bomber might bench Chubb. I don't know. I haven't seen anything, but he's got the 1 seed locked up. I don't know what he's going to do. I still think that's a tough game for Woods to win, no matter what Bomber does, to be honest with you, because Bomber's an excellent player. I think he could beat him with his backups. No offense. He could beat most people with his backups. But DMuz could also slide into the I think he could slide into the 6 seed, right? Because he would, because Packers have the tie? Or no? Not yet. He would be 9-7-1, and DMuz would be 10-7. So he's playing for a lot. He's playing to get in. I think he can increase his seeding by one. So I think he's going to focus up and win that game. I don't know how you go from losing to Fig to beating QP. Hopefully DMuz can straighten that out, especially going into season 3. But I want to see him in the playoffs because I think he can make some noise. So give me him over NYT in a close one.
That's a lot of math, but I'm going to take NYT. I think he's just been the better player this season. All right, let's pick up the pace a little bit. We promised a shorter episode. Let's make it a shorter episode. Jets, Steelers, go.
Jets.
Ouch. Okay, well, we all saw that coming. Congrats on your free win, DW. all right, no more.
I don't think I can stop his run game. If I can stop his run game, I'll beat him. If I can't, he's gonna win. So it's strength against strength. He can run the ball, I can stop it, so something's got to give.
I'm still taking you. I'm sorry. I mean listen, DW is a good player. I don't think he's gonna beat you. I mean, you are theoretically still in the playoff hunt, but I don't think it'll matter. But it's a big game for you. You already said you're going to lose, so let's not drag that out any longer. All right, 9-6-1 Packers, another good rebounded team versus the 12-4 Lions, who, let me check the standings real fast. I don't have enough web pages. The Lions have not clinched the 1 seed, I think. Yeah, they have not clinched the 1 seed, so they still need a win or a Cardinals loss. And I just missed the other team we were talking about. And the Packers, they've rebounded very nicely, and they are, I think they've clinched a playoff spot. Yes? No? Yes. Not, no.
No, they have haven't, not.
Because 10-7 is better than 9-7-1, right? Yeah. Yeah? Yes.
Yep.
Okay. Ties make things confusing. Okay, so Packers need to win. Lions need to win. Man, you just can't get in the way of the Lions. And when they need to win and be like, oh, hey, I'm confident I'm going to win this game. The Lions are just... What QB has done with that team in two seasons is ridiculous. He turned that team from Jared Goff and a bunch of no-name wide receivers into Justin Herbert, a rookie Quan Studemeyer, Will Fuller, Mike Williams, and that's it. Hunter Bryant, I don't think, was on the team before, but he is now. It's just... then you add names like Jordan Poyer, Rashawn Evans on the defense. You've got some good, talented guys in Tanner Muse, Jeff Okuda. It's just ridiculous that this Lions team has become so good so fast, and they've still got room to improve. So I'm taking the Lions.
Yeah, I think the entire NFC should be glad that QP didn't get a better team, because, like you said, even though he's built this team up, there's still work to do, especially defensively. I'm actually, even Monty and I, Monty came into the league, him and I hit it off. I mean, he likes Coors Light, I like Coors Light. I mean, that right there, you got my heart. But then he started talking about well-done steak and A1 sauce, and we kind of fell out. But we're only talking football here. We're not talking steak and beer. So
are you sure? We could start a podcast on that.
Now I want a steak and beer. But I'm high on Monty. I don't like the Aaron Rodgers trade for him. I know all the primer groupies said, oh, he doesn't need a quarterback to win, blah, 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 blah. Well, he's 9-6-1, so maybe he does. But with Mac Jones, he is statistically doing well. And he is going to beat QP. He's going to get into the playoffs, and not this season, but in the next season or two, he will be in the NFC Championship game. That is my... You went out on a limb and said the Colts are going to win the AFC South. I'm going to say that the Packers in the next season or the next two seasons, one of them, he will be in the NFC Championship game.
So you think that NFC playoff picture gets crowded then, huh? At least at the top.
Absolutely. Dump's got the best. I mean, he's got the Arizona Cardinals. That's like a super team this year. And he's struggling. QP, hit or miss. And he lost to me, for God's sakes, last season. Noel is Noel. He's doing great. But, I mean, I can't quite give him my vote of confidence yet. Klink has got some offensive demons. There is the football team fluke. But, I mean, I expect a lot out of Monty. And I know maybe I'm putting pressure on him. But he's my dark horse in the NFC to start making noise next season.
I like it. All right. We already sort of touched on this game. Panthers-Browns. So just, I'm going to take the Browns. I don't think, even if the Browns aren't playing for anything, they've got the one seed locked up. However, even if you take the starters out of this game for the Browns, you bench Mayfield, you bench Odell, Landry if you wanted to, Schwartz even, Nick Chubb, you bench all of them, I still think the Browns win. I'm sorry, Woods, I think the Browns win.
How can you bet against Bomber? I mean, great season, Woods. You know, you're a surprise 9-7. You know, I that's a great season, but I mean, his rookie quarterback Christian Coleman, 25 touchdowns, 38 interceptions. You just talked about, if you have more interceptions than touchdowns, it's not a good sign. Obviously, that's not even close. That's 13 more interceptions. You can get away with that against bad players, and he kicked the crap out of me, so I'm talking to myself here. But whether Bomber rest starters or not, Woods is gonna turn the ball over. We know that. Bomber's not going to do that, so Bomber's going to win this game. It's a tough draw for Woods because, you know, he has a chance to make the playoffs, but it's just not going to happen.
Hey, listen, you got to play the games on your schedule. It doesn't matter what order they're in. So if Woods is going to lose this game, he was going to lose it 10 weeks ago or whatever. So, yeah, tough to have at week 18. But, hey, you saw the schedule came out when it came out, whatever, 6 real-life weeks ago. So,
yeah, and, you know, him and Klink, if they both lost, they would both be 9-8. They split their head-to-head, so you'd be looking at some in-depth tiebreakers. Maybe he gets in with a loss if Klink also loses. There's a lot of interesting scenarios here, but I think Woods has to just be rooting for a Klink loss and then hope that the Madden tiebreaker gods help him out, which I don't think they will, because if Klink beats Pauly, they would have the same division record at 5-1. I think then it goes to conference record, which Klink has over him. So again, there's too much math in this show already, but I think Woods has to win to get in, and I don't see it happening.
As the resident numbers guy, yeah, this is too much math. All right, last game on the docket for the episode. The surprisingly 8-8 Rams versus the unsurprisingly 3-13 Falcons. The Rams, listen, I'm impressed with what Colton has done this season. I have not seen if those were all quality wins or not, and they probably weren't. But listen, this might be his best season maybe ever since joining the SML. I don't know if he's ever had a winning record before. He's got a chance to secure that. He's got an outside chance at the playoffs. He's got a win over Dan. He's got a win over Woods, a big win over Woods. He beat the Giants. He beat Pauly, which at the time was probably bigger than it turned out to be. Yeah, so hey, good on you. You've been winning the games that you're supposed to win. You've also been losing a bunch of games. You lost to the I take it back. You haven't been winning every game that you should have. Lost to the Patriots. It's late. I don't feel like doing all this math right now. But like I said, I mean, hey, 8-8 for the Rams. That's good season. You win this game against the team that you are favored against, finish 9-8. I think you rest your head happy that you, hey, despite everything, all the crap you've got on the podcast for cutting Cooper Kupp and superstar punter for no reason whatsoever, hey, you got an outside shot at the playoffs. I think you can build off of that. I'm going to take the Rams.
Yeah, you know, I like, you know, Colts had a great season. You know, I think he was down after the end of last season because I think he started to realize that, the Rams have some decent talent, but they have a lot of holes and they don't have a lot of money and flexibility. And so I think that kind of burned him out a little bit. But, you know, he comes back, he has a great season. He's actually recently, especially after beating Dan, he's kind of gotten a little bit involved in chat. He chirped at me actually today or yesterday, and I don't know when it was, but he chirped at me in chat because Brissett and Haskins have about the same overall, and Brissett has better numbers. So he chirped at me out of nowhere. I don't know where that even came from, but I love it. I mean, that's just, when's the last time you saw Colt chirp at somebody in chat or get, you know, super active? So I like that. I hope he keeps the momentum. He's probably not going to make the playoffs, but he's got good wins. He beat Dan. Say what you will, that's a heck of a win. Dan gave him all the kudos in the world. He has a nice win against the Raiders, so he went 3-1 against the AFC West. They only lost to Prime. And that's arguably one of the tougher divisions. So I hope that Colt can build off of this. I hope that he continues to stay motivated and I hope he doesn't make more dumb roster decisions like he did cutting Cooper Kupp for a guy who's not even on his team anymore. But yeah, give me the Rams. TTS, I don't know. He's playing like we expect, and Colt should win this game and build the momentum going forward.
Full transparency, I was just playing some birds chirping, and I know you didn't hear it, but the listeners did. And right as you said the name Dan, a crow called in the background. And if that's not just divine intervention, that is now proof from Jesus himself that Dan was tanking. All right, guys, I think that does it for this episode. Thanks for listening. We gave you an episode that is 5 minutes shorter than normal. We're not going to miss 2 weeks in a row again. I lied. We probably will, but we don't plan to. Thanks for listening, guys, and we'll catch you next week.